Coming up on this episode of The Roundtable.
Right? He's like, I'd rather die than have the economy die. And
I'll say this for the third time in the history of this podcast. Shut this down
now. Shut this podcast down.
Emancipating yourself from your disgusting, repulsive clay body and ascending to the level of pure spirit. I'm just waiting for the...
Well, welcome everyone to another episode of The Roundtable, the podcast of the American Mind. I'm your host, Ryan Williams, president of the Claremont Institute and publisher of the Claremont Review of Books. We're all sheltering in place across greater Southern California, except for David Barr, of course, who's in the swamp. But I'm joined, as I usually am, by Matthew Peterson, our vice president of education and founding editor of the American Mind, James Poulos, executive editor of the American Mind, just to mix up the order. David Barr from the Swamp, managing editor of the American Mind, and Spencer Clavin, assistant editor both of the American Mind and the Claremont Review of Books. So without further ado, the show from the bunker via Zoom, among other technological developments. Let's get started. So we thought we might do a bit of mailbag for a couple of these segments today, at least. I mean, we're of course going to talk about the only thing that everyone's thinking about right now, which is the lockdown in various states. I think we're being in California, and you live in Maryland, right? Right, Barr?
Yeah.
So you're locked down too, right?
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
So we're fully locked down here in both our states. We have a dwindling number of states that aren't in full lockdown, but we're in full lockdown. So we're happy to be with you all, and we wanted to just answer some of the questions that have been building up over the recent months, and then especially aggressively over the last week or two. So I thought we'd start with a response to Matt Peterson's retweet of James's call for mailbag options, and that's from Kurt Peters. We thought we'd start with something very uncontroversial, and his question is, is COVID being used for a civil war inside the U.S. between two factions? I'll just kick us off with this one or two observations. It's interesting, you know, I think it's going to increasingly become the case, or it has over the last week, especially with the way Trump's been talking about it. It's begun to polarize along partisan lines and along blue and red state lines, although that's not a perfect division. And I think what's underappreciated about this crisis, in a way, is the extent to which it's shifting the Overton window on conversation or a question that's been bubbling up in our politics as we find ourselves in what we've characterized as cold civil war. And that's the question of national divorce, as some people put it, or secession, as it was known over a century ago in our greatest regime crisis. I offer no endorsement one way or the other. I will say that at the Claremont Institute, we've long been anti-secession, but I think a lot of people are sort of starkly reminded of our divisions over questions of justice, our geographical divisions and they're all just being put into stark relief, I think, to the extent that we divide both geographically and politically over this question of what to do about this and the extent of this crisis brought on by the CCP virus.
Yeah.
Or the Chinese Communist phrase. Party virus. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I think this is interesting. And, you know, the biggest signal to me of politically how we're in uncharted waters was actually the close cooperation between Gavin Newsom and Donald Trump on this, which I would wager is set to continue. We don't hear quite as much about the Cuomo-Trump relationship. Plenty of reasons to speculate about that. But it looks like, as it stands, we're heading into a situation where B people's abstract ideological commitments to union or national divorce, as they may, the simple realities of the real differences within states, between groups of Americans, are coming to the fore. And the limits of those differences are also coming to the fore. For my Girardian friends and listeners out there, you know, the cycle of scapegoating suggests that humans are always about one or two steps away from giving in to the desire to just start murdering each other. And I don't think we should take that lightly. I don't think we're going to tip into civil war tomorrow or next week or even 2 weeks after that. But going back to Lincoln, as we are wont to do at the Claremont Institute, he tried as hard as he could to encourage and urge Americans to remain friends, to at least be able to maintain the sort of memories that were capable of nourishing a retrieval of friendship, even after the war. And one of the great tragedies of the war, of course, there were many, is that Lincoln was killed and was not able to oversee Reconstruction. And instead, what we got was a Congress that carved the South into military districts and took an approach that was political, but I think more than political, that was not what Lincoln's approach would have been. And so that temptation reaches deep into the human psyche, and we've seen it play out in America before. So I think, you know, to the degree that we can recognize that our differences at this point are quite real in different areas, and recognize that we can have a world where in some ways the federal government is more authoritative, but less powerful, as different states take, you know, different approaches that are ultimately driven by stark realities, hopefully we can avoid anything that even looks like civil war.
I mean, it's noble sentiments, but let me play devil's advocate a little bit. So I think that if this crisis went on longer, if it goes on longer, I think you would see federalism come into play, as it already has in the Trump era, in a very serious way, where blue states, right, are asserting independence against a red state president. And I'll just be cynical about it. I think there's some truth to what you say, but the cynical reply would be, well, Gavin, unlike Cuomo, I mean, Cuomo's a legal gangster, basically. He's grown up a legal gangster in New York, and he has a developed lizard brain, and he's tougher. Gavin is kind of an effete prince. I mean, he comes from the innerbred families that rule San Francisco, and I think he's scared. I mean, I think he's terrified politically. This is a very difficult situation for him, so I think he's going to play nice, and Trump likes that. Trump sees this instinctively, whereas Cuomo, you know, he's a tougher customer. So I think that the interesting thing is the aggravation of this blue state, red state divide, and we should talk about this. I mean, James wrote this I think quite interesting essay about green zones, which are Balaji on Twitter has coined this phrase, green zones where the virus isn't, and red zones where the virus is. And right now, as many commentators have noted, if you look at a map, it correlates roughly, not perfectly, it's not the same thing, but it correlates roughly to red counties and blue counties, right? And so I think a lot of people are thinking right now, when you look at the map, okay, well, wouldn't the reaction to the coronavirus be bifurcated, because a lot of red states or red counties don't have the problem, and blue states or blue counties do have the problem, and blue states will be tempted to bunker down and ratchet up the enforcement of this lockdown, and red states will say, as you know, Idaho is the example a lot of people use, will say, we don't have this, why the hell are we locking down at all? And you can kind of see this divide almost, you know, growing during this time. And I'm torn about it, because on the one hand, it is, I think you can see on the map this divide growing, and over the next couple of weeks, the deeper the crisis is, the more the varied responses will vary, because Trump ultimately isn't in charge. The governors and local authorities will be in charge of enforcement, you know, in each of their respective regions. So, I mean, on the other hand, I agree with James. I mean, there's all kinds of weird. The response to the virus doesn't respect party lines, I don't think, yet. Anyway, does that make any sense to anyone?
Well, yeah, I just, you know, like I was scrolling through tweets today, believe it or not, you know, someone chimed in like, hey, if it's in rural Alabama, it's everywhere. Every state is a hot spot. We know in California, you know, Fresno is a hot spot. Clearly the big cities have the major problems. And here, you know, in L.A., Eric Garcetti has given us less than 2 weeks to hit the peak that New York is hitting. And it's true. People are scared and justifiably so, I think. But it's, you know, it's a little more complicated than red state, blue state.
That's right. I agree with that. I mean, it's not the same.
But, you know, but definitely there are governors and other state level politicians who would very much like it to be a red state, blue state thing. You know, hopefully, as we if we can work on moving toward a sort of green zone model, and I sort of developed this out at least at a first cut on the website for anyone who wants to while away their hours.
Which website is that, James? I'm not.
That's AmericanMind.org, Matt. AmericanMind.org.
Man, that's a great website. AmericanMind.org. I love that website. I go there so often.
The zones, virus-free zones don't have to be big in order to be important. They can be county level. They can be neighborhood level. They can be, you know, hey, I'm fortunate enough to have 500 acres of land and a well and a couple cabins. Come hang out. You know, this isn't the kind of thing that is like the world is ending and meet me at the end, at the family shed. You know, the world isn't ending. Things are going to get choppy, but humanity survived even crazier crises than this before. And I think we'll come through on this one too. You know, this in a way is a return to reopening our frontier and the resources of our interior in a way that's just going to pay dividends going into the future, regardless, I think.
I want to turn around and say, so this division that you speak of, because it's confusing to people, right? I mean, so, okay, red zone where the virus is and green zone does not respect political blue, blue-red divide. Okay, so what are we talking about? And I think where it transcends partisan lines is when you talk in the essay about the dissatisfaction of many people in urban, you know, mostly urban areas, coastal cities, at millennials especially, who they've gone there. You've written about this before. We've all talked about this. They've gone there with this creative class stuff, and they thought everything was going to be great. Now they realize, I'm not married. I'm in my 30s. My life sucks. The whole economy is not so great here for raising a family, and I want a change of pace. I want a different lifestyle. And a lot of people have said that for years. I say over the last, since the crash, you know, over for 15 years or so, people will say that in wealthier, sexier zip codes. But I really think the virus is going to, the effects of this is going to push people into thinking more seriously about actually picking up and moving and going to a quote unquote green zone. And am I crazy in thinking that? I mean, I know James is saying that. I'm curious what the rest of you guys think.
Well, I think it'll be very interesting if things do develop somewhat along the lines that you guys are describing. And I think James outlines a very plausible and one of the few realist visions of where this could go in his essay. And if those green zones and red zones end up aligning somewhere close to the red state, red region, blue region divide, or even if the green zones simply end up being rural areas where people adopt practices and live lives that look more like rural lives and are conducted according to certain principles that urban life is currently not in America. It will be fascinating to see, because if the green zones are going to expand outward and if the red zones are going to eventually become green zones, then the cost of that for red zones and for people who live in urban areas will be adopting some of those practices, will be changing some of the practices that have so doomed urban centers in America, that our regard toward the way that we treat homeless people, the way that we think about homelessness as a problem would be one, you know, obvious example, but the way that we think about public health more generally. And really, it'll come down to the wire, I think, as a question whether those red zones would rather die than adopt different cultural practices and think about urban life differently and think about human life differently. And I think that's actually an open question. I genuinely believe that the grip of ideology is strong enough in places like San Francisco that you may see people simply not willing to go there.
Which is fascinating, because you got the lieutenant governor of Texas, I think, who was out front saying the same thing from the other side of the ideological divide, right?
He's right.
Like, I'd rather die than have the economy die.
And, exactly.
You know, I don't know. Like, that's cool in one sense, but in another sense, you know, it could be that readiness to expire for an idea is present on both sides. Sorry, David, go ahead.
Yeah, I had a question for you. How much of this theory of, say, decamping for a different zone is predicated on the coronavirus really setting in and taking lives. That is, how much is predicated on it impacting us to the extent where we are ready to make these wholesale moves and upheavals of our lives in the way that you're kind of talking about it? Or if it's kind of, and this is harkening back to a poll that Matt Peterson had on Twitter regarding our intuition or gut feeling about the coronavirus. Is it here today, gone tomorrow? If it's here today, gone tomorrow, and things return to kind of normal within a month's time, do you still see, James, the potential for the phenomena you're describing is decreasing? Or
I think that your mileage may vary, as they say on the internet. But yeah, I think that even if things go back to nominally normal, people are going to be concerned, and not crazily so, about a potential second wave. If you really get into the weeds on China news, you can see that they're now getting coronavirus from return, sort of people returning to China from abroad. There's a hantavirus outbreak in China. People are going to be nervous. We'll see who is ready to send their kids back to school in September. That is still obscured in the future. But I was reading an LA Times piece. I'm going to be the guy to actually quote the LA Times on the Roundtable podcast.
A first.
Probably for the first and last time. No, so this is a piece from 2 days ago entitled "Hoping to Escape Coronavirus, City Dwellers Are Fleeing to California's Deserts and Mountains." Believe it or not. Of course, they open with sort of human interest vignette. And they go on to say, as the pandemic tightens its grip on California's largest cities, some residents are fleeing urban sprawl and seeking shelter in isolated communities in the Mojave Desert or rugged Sierra Nevada. Good branding in there. Their hope, they say, is to avoid possible public unrest and limit their exposure to the virus. These new urban immigrants are not entirely welcome, however. Locals fear their arrival could overwhelm the public health systems of small towns already struggling to cope with the growing crisis. And public health officials worry the movement will lead to greater spread of the highly contagious virus. In Mammoth Lakes, a small eastern Sierra town that survives primarily on skiing at Mammoth Mountain, the tourism board last week told non-residents to keep out. The reason is simple. The board's website announced, as a small remote mountain community, our healthcare facilities lack the capacity to handle a widespread outbreak of COVID-19. The migration appears to be driven by fear and the nation's sudden shift toward teleworking, which has afforded urban residents greater freedom to roam. This is going to happen. If it happens in an orderly fashion, it's going to be good for us. If it's a free-for-all and there's no coordination between local, state, and federal authorities, things could get sketchy. We should start figuring out now how to work together so that people can flow toward green zones in a way that is going to be orderly and standardized to some extent, and strengthens communities rather than weakening them.
So as regards to this poll that we conducted on Twitter, the question was, which is closest to your gut level opinion? And there were only three options: Great Depression 2, a recession like 2008, or this will blow over soon. And with a very unscientific sample, I think a lot of Make America Great Again fans were retweeting it. The results were, to me, sort of astounding. I mean, 65.6% of 6,811 votes said this will blow over soon. And 18% said it'd be a recession like 2008. And 16% said it'll be a Great Depression, too. So the vast majority of people were very optimistic. And, you know, I wonder if there's some wisdom in this or not, because I know lots of people at the elite level who have a lot of money invested, and all the way through the entire spectrum. And I was actually very surprised that people were so complacent, or they thought, you know, this isn't really a big deal.
Yeah, we should note for the record that Matt now sounds like he's living under an underwater aquarium or pool, maybe. But his
weird, but
he's moved to a secure location.
We're all, with all of Los Angeles streaming Netflix. or Pornhub at the moment. The bandwidth is getting throttled, so Matt's Zoom connection went south. We like to think, for now, we don't have any visual evidence, but Matt's still talking, so we have audio evidence that it's not, in fact, an outbreak of CCP virus zombies that have cut his internet. So we're going old school.
I'm still
in this
alive. The still Stafford Act is not in effect. And
proof of life.
Mr. Garcetti has not declared martial law yet.
Yeah, but Spencer, you want to jump in?
Well, Matt, I wonder about that poll that you conducted, because that was a surprising result to me too. And one part of me just wants to
what
say,
what was your R squared? It was not scientific.
That's right. I wonder about your methodology. No, that's not what I wonder. I don't mean
look,
I wonder.
Look, I'm the first one to say, I conducted hundreds of thousands of people as part of my job in the past. So I'm the first to say it's not scientific, et cetera. But it was bizarre to me, and it almost made me think about bots, because 6,811 votes. This is not really a poll in the scientific sense, and I only gave three options. So if you didn't think there was a recession like 2008, and you thought there'd be something between that and this will blow over soon, you didn't really have a lot of options. So you would have went with this will blow over soon. But still,
well, yeah, I mean
65.6%.
Right. I mean, that's not actually what I wondered, because Twitter polls are notoriously ridiculous. I think the last one of the last ones I conducted was like, are the bots on Star Wars sentient? And then I'm going into the kitchen, do you want a snack? So these are all, I mean, this is kind of the level of statistical.
Yeah, well, what were you going to say?
Well, what I was going to say was that, I think two things may be true. First of all, it may just be that the optimism of the American people is a well that never runs dry. But it may also be that two things are true. People have an intuition that this event is going to reshape our economy in a number of ways that may make paradigms from the past, like the Great Depression or even the recession of 2008, unfit as models for anything good or bad that will happen in this sort of uncharted territory that we're sailing forth into. And then the second thing that may be true is that because of their vast reserves of optimism, people are thinking that whatever it is that comes out of this that is new will be something that we can get behind and be excited about. And that's actually that part of it. That's a version of the answer that I could get behind. I could get behind, well, this is going to be deeply troubling to our currently existing structures of economic arrangement, but it's going to eventually create something, and maybe is going to create something quickly and soon that will actually end up liking better. That's the most sort of rational version of it's all going to blow over soon that I can think of, because that would mean that you wouldn't really be able to choose, well, it's going to be like anything in the past. It's going to be something totally new, but the new thing is going to be okay or good. I'm just spitballing here, but that's why, if I were answering that poll, that would be why I would answer it's going to blow over. But I didn't answer, and that's not what I would answer.
Yeah, if I could just get back to to James's point about green zones. I think one effect that this has had, so one of our themes, a long-running themes at the Claremont Institute, and it's germane, I mean, we've brought it up on this podcast, I think the last episode maybe I did or the one before. We've always thought, as good students of history and the history of regimes and political organizations, et cetera, that, we don't think it's hyperbolic to say that this experiment in self-government could end badly or could devolve into something much more unpleasant. And I think that's sort of a theoretical question that those of us who spend our time studying the history of political systems and how they decline in what seems like a somewhat predictable cycle, but can be forestalled or interrupted or reformed, of course, going all the way back to Aristotle. I think that theoretical argument, and then which is buttressed by historical examples, has seemed very distant, I think, to people in modernity and post-modernity. Very distant, I think, to the West since World War II, and especially since the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of the Cold War. So I think one of the I don't want to call it a silver lining because that seems kind of very gallows humor, but it's just to remind everyone in a material way, I think, that you know we're kind of one pandemic, whether it be biological or political, one pandemic away from real breakdown, and I think that's a healthy thing to understand, and I think that to the extent that we're thinking anew about where our homestead is out in the middle of nowhere where we can be safe, you know, as Spencer will remind us, no one's ultimately safe where none of us get out of this alive, this life here on Earth. But I think to the extent that it forces us to think a bit about regime stability and, you know, the external threats and external biological threats, and I think that's all pretty healthy. I think we've been too complacent for too long about the extent to which this thing that we call prosperous, and as we're noticing in recent times in a new way, debt-fueled prosperity, you know, it's kind of fragile. So to the extent that we can get back to basics and think seriously about how we preserve what is good and avert what is bad, you know, that'll be one decent outcome of this whole crisis.
There's something really important, I think, that emerges from that, which you just said, Ryan, which is itself very important. But in addition, since this is a crisis which drives us in some ways back to our foundations, back to basics, back to thinking about what is permanent and what is impermanent, and since it kind of makes Claremont's point that regimes like America's are not, in fact, inherently endurant and stable, but in fact rather highly volatile and in need of maintenance and care, there's a tendency, I think, among commentators on this issue to speak about the developments that are about to ensue as if they were going to emerge organically. Well, people will be sent back to their homes, and then they'll start thinking about how good it is to be home with their family. Maybe instead they'll start thinking about how good it is to be home with their Pornhub, right? None of these developments are predetermined, but all of them are potential developments out of what's happening to us right now. And the key difference will be who makes the argument most effectively. I mean, we actually have to be arguing for people deriving something good out of this. And it's not a sort of hard and fast guarantee that when people go back to basics, what will emerge is a refreshing, harmonious vision of the American polity. It's a potential thing that might emerge, but there's plenty of other much worse stuff that might emerge. And that's why it's actually quite crucial that we be thinking about what we want to emerge and then working toward making that happen.
So I think Spencer is dead on here. There's no guarantee where this goes and what trends accelerate because of the coronavirus. And it could easily make us more slavish. It could devolve us into a kind of caste system, which, to be honest, the way things are going is certainly the trend. The trend is there's citizenship at the elite level. There's citizenship at the nominal level. And then there's a kind of underclass that, you know, is in many ways illegal and criminal beneath that. So that could certainly accelerate. But I think the hope lies in removing the obstacles to the natural desires of human beings. And this goes to some of what James says in his essay about green zones at theamericanmind.org. There are all kinds of, especially millennials, who are in their 30s and who realize, you know, they don't have religion, they don't have conservative or liberal tropes necessarily in their mind. They've imbibed stuff from the liberal media, yeah, sure. But they're not really political. And they're looking around and looking at the reality that they live in. And things can always get worse. Don't worry, I'm a pessimist. But also, nature bites back. And you really have an extreme situation in which people are being pushed to the max to accept working for a corporation that doesn't care about them at all, 80 hours a week, and they want status from that. But the status in their real lives is living in a small apartment, not being able to buy a house or have a family,
you know, everyone on these online dating apps is insane. And so there's something about removing the obstacles and saying there's a new frontier in the interior, you know, paving the way for people just follow out what naturally makes them happy. And so, you know, I don't know if that's optimism per se, but I do think there's a path forward that doesn't have to go into some, you know, an even more dystopian landscape than we already have.
Well, I can't think of a better way to end that part of the discussion. We've gone way over for our current mailbag. Of course, as you all have noticed, we've answered tons of questions from the mailbag. Gosh. We actually only took up one, but I think we hit on a few others through the discussion. So that was great. But and this will be a new segment for us, I think, because we want to encourage everyone to engage. And in many ways, this is why we do what we do. Engaging the argument through our friends and readers is very gratifying. So thank you all.
That question was the Leibnizian monad through which all other questions were contained.
It was. Yeah.
They all emerged.
Civil War?
That's right.
Yeah.
Civil War.
Green zones, homesteads.
That's right. One big riff.
All right. Well, having run quite long on mailbag number one, we thought we'd move on to mailbag number two and have just a bit of fun. We get a mix. You'll all be shocked to learn that we get both serious questions in the mailbag and then trollish questions. So one I wanted to bring up just to launch us in this segment, and it was asked of our dear, dear friend and colleague David Barr from his friend Alex. When do you think the virus will finally claim David Barr's life? David, any comment?
Well, I officiated that guy's wedding. Alex Priou. He's a philosopher, which means you can't trust him around the livestock, if you know what I'm saying.
Of course not.
But I do want to say that I appreciate long-time listener, first-time caller questions. So thank you, Alex. Book on the farm entities, which everybody should buy. It's also a bit.
Well, David, there's good news when you're done there. Go ahead.
That last comment I made.
Yeah.
I wasn't counting on you to finish on that note, but I will try to fill your heart with gladness. Father Steve is in the mailbag. He wants to know if social isolation will reinforce Gnostic tendencies, seeing the body as a meat puppet to be used for pleasure, or whether it'll swing us back to appreciating embodiment. And so I say to you that before you have to rise or fall before the judgment of your dear friend, you do always have the option of simply emancipating yourself from your disgusting, repulsive clay body and ascending to the level of pure spirit. All of us can do this. We can live forever as hovering presences unlocked by the true light.
Yeah. What are you intimating something?
COVID-19 is actually a comet. And inside of the comet, there's a spaceship. And this spaceship has aliens that love us. They're waiting for us to join them.
Yeah. Where was that? That was on a nice piece of land. That was like a kind of
the Branch Davidian compound.
Outside. Yeah.
Bars.
David. I received a comment from your quote unquote friend, Alex, this quote unquote philosopher. And he said, I spoke with David Barr earlier today, and he seemed to think COVID-19 was medication for foot fungus. My question, how deep is David Barr's shameful ignorance? But when I read the question, I thought like a critical literature scholar, and it struck me that there was a deep foot fetish buried at the core of this for Alex. Like, why does he want to talk about your feet? You know, I mean, why does he
Why does he want you to reveal your feet? And how deep is your ignorance about your feet? It's very weird to me.
I'll say this for the third time in the history of this podcast, which was first enunciated by Spencer, which was shut this podcast down.
Well, when I said that it was inevitable that we would one day talk about tentacle porn, you were like, no, it was not inevitable. But I just want to claim vindication here, because obviously a podcast that's going to talk about David Barr's feet is going to be a podcast that's talking about it. Anyway, look, bars.
I'm not into your dirty feet.
Sure.
But I do think that maybe your friend Alex, he might pay you something to send a picture of your foot to him.
This is why we can't have total lockdown for an extended period of time, is because every American on a long enough timeline will become a participant in the foot fetish economy.
Yeah, he's a Persian, and he has big hairy feet, and we all remember. No, it's true. It's not a dick. It's just a diss to Alex. But you remember what Herodotus says about hairy feet, right, Spencer?
I confess to you, David Barr, I do not remember what Herodotus says about.
Twice.
I don't have the PhD.
You can't put me on the spot like this, man.
The first time Spencer drops a site, it happened, ladies and gentlemen. First and only time.
I'm currently in the process of trying to figure out what the Attic Greek equivalent for troll is. That I committed myself to that this morning.
It came up in a Claremont Review Books meeting, actually.
Just so you know what kind of raucous debauch occurs at Claremont Review. Well, Barr's problem is that for the rest of us, when we scrape past our disgusting clay body and emancipate whatever lies within, we get the divine spark of reason, truth, and beauty that was always meant to emerge. But David Barr, it's turtles all the way down, man. It's like a Russian doll of depravity. If you scrape away one layer of clay, earthbound depravity, you just get another muck, ceaseless morass of muck. No, this...
we need to keep Barr alive because he is a one-man refutation of Gnosticism.
That's right. That's right. True. We kid because
his
we
body
love...
refutes it.
But really, I mean that guy's question, right? Are we gonna is this gonna be an impetus for more just bug life in the pod with porn, or is it gonna be a return to kind of appreciating our embodied lives? Like that goes right back to what we were talking about at the end of this previous segment. It's like, yes and yes. It could be one thing, could be another. People could easily go either way. It's not a predetermined outcome that people will become enlightened through this experience, or that they will become yet further degraded through this experience. They're seeds of both developments.
You know, we talked a little bit on the last podcast about the the John Lennon song "Imagine." I'm sorely tempted to do a song called "Don't Imagine." I have a rule in my house, and I try to take this rule wherever I can go in digital life, if not outside my house, because I'm quarantined. Is no what ifs. Don't ask what if, and then pose a question. There's another way of saying what's on your mind, and it doesn't involve giving in and letting your imagination run away with yourself. That said, so many people, I hope it's not as many as I feel like it is, have at some point or the other over the past however many years said something along the lines of, oh, I could never bring a child into this world. Yeah. And now, you know, I think we are headed into a moment where people might start saying something like, oh my God, I need to bring a child into this world. And that's something that, you know, the anti-child constituency simply could not have imagined.
Yeah, I love that constituency. And when they get COVID-19 and they need a support system, whoops.
Well, if things continue on this trajectory, and I think this is fairly non-controversial, global population is going to be down. You know, it's just something that's going to make the world an emptier place in some ways, but a larger place in others. And it's going to throw us back, I think, on a new seriousness about the importance of generating human life.
Yeah. So this is something that I get the whole, I hear the objections in my head as soon as we start talking this way, you know, especially over drinks, you know, saying this will lead to some good, positive trends. Spencer's warning in the beginning, I hear that every day. I mean, you know, every second in my head. But the fact of the matter is, I do think that the natural desire to procreate, the natural desire to have a country, to have a place, a community you call one's own, is powerful. And, you know, right now, the biggest obstacle to that, let's take a couple of them. I mean, globalization is a big obstacle to that. You think, well, we're all struggling, and you know, the economy is such that it's splayed all over the world. And now you all of a sudden see, no, it's not inevitable. Globalization is not inevitable. That's the fundamental assumption that is now being questioned and thrown out by the American people. Even the European Union can establish borders. Every country in the world is able to establish borders and say, no, we can cut off what's outside, not because we're racist or we hate people, but because we want to work on what's inside and keep it healthy, right? And that goes to what James is saying. There's a turn inward right now going on in the Western world where we say, how really healthy are we? How can we be healthy as individuals within our, you know, spiritual or soul lives or within our bodily lives? And what do we really want to make us happy? And this turn inward means establishing boundaries and borders. And just like in a relationship, boundaries are necessary, not because you're you know, a bad person, but because you want to actually develop and strengthen yourself and other people. And part of that is saying, I want to have a family. And it's astounding to me. This is one of Tucker Carlson's most brilliant points when he says, if you want to be president of the United States, you would just have to tell people, I want to make it so that you could have one parent working and one parent not raising kids and have families. And regardless of how postmodern, modern, or whatever American society is, people still want to have families. Millennials want to have families. And this is powerful. You can't the amount of social capital it takes to eradicate this is astounding when you think about it. So I don't know. I wouldn't say that's an optimistic point, but it's certainly a powerful current that could be unleashed soon.
The other piece of this is, you know, I mentioned this a little bit in the essay as well, is, you know, Alexis de Tocqueville's, you know, black pill scenario for America is that small-minded egotism just gradually conquers everyone. And it doesn't just shortcut straight to like selfish people wandering around focused on themselves in a sociopathic way. First, it constricts social life down to the family, down to the nuclear family. And then it goes to, you know, people even within the nuclear family sort of retreating into their own brooding souls, never to completely emerge and participate even in the family life that just, you know, perhaps one generation before seemed to be the center of it all. So, you know, the family is a part of a larger puzzle. And I think for many years, even decades, many folks on the right felt as if they were obliged to retreat into these sort of beloved fantasies, fueled in part by memory, to be sure, but in large measure, just sort of, you know, well, if we can just sort of think up what would be a more beautiful and more whole world and just, you know, concentrate on that vision in our heads and wait, then like maybe one day. Well, like one day is here, and it isn't here because, you know, you click your heels together and say there's no place like home. It's here because the world is inescapable, and it has its way with us. Globalization is the idea that humans can rule the world, and worldwide we're learning that no, it's actually not that simple. And so the reality of the situation that's unfolding now is one that I think is orienting people towards saying, oh wow, here's, you know, something like subsidiarity that can unfold in reality, in practice, as a prudential measure, not as, you know, taking an ideology out of the box and saying, oh, it's a starter kit, and how can we, you know, artificially construct something that is an approximation of, you know, this abstract ideal that we have in our heads. This is much more tangible and concrete.
No, I agree with that, and I think conservatives, I mean, I don't even know what to say about that. But I think that the organic natural desire of just people out there outside of ideology is surging right now, and it doesn't necessarily need to go in a good way. But you know, you see it constrained against these strictures and fences and boundaries that, you know, I'm saying liberal, just mainstream, you know, globalized society has placed on them. And there's a real urge. This is not your bow-tied conservative, you know, talking about Russell Kirk. We're not talking about your Wendell Berry, you know, want to go down on Berry's farm type, you know, person. We're not talking about intellectualizing this. There's just a deep rooted desire that's breaking forth from people to say, I don't want this. I don't like this. And again, it doesn't necessarily mean it goes in a right way. But what's needed by politicians and intellectuals is not so much, you know, thinking through fine 5-year plans and so forth, but just getting rid of those obstacles and letting people pursue happiness in a deeper sense. And I don't want to make that so simplistic. I'm very pessimistic in many ways about where this goes. But I think a lot of politics, the old conservative notion is true. A lot of politics is just getting rid of obstacles and letting certain channels of motivation, of human desire flow in certain directions. And in a way, that's what politics is, I think.
Yeah, there's an important distinction, Matt, that I think you're making here between some things are organic. It's not as if nothing will naturally emerge out of a people that is forced back down to its basics. And on some level, conservatives must believe that our basic organic impulses, things like wanting to have babies, wanting to be in physical and natural relationship with the people around you, those sorts of things must be good on some level. So this kind of pessimist caution that I'm issuing shouldn't be taken to mean that there's nothing good at the bedrock of humanity. But also, I think, as post-lapsarian man, as people who live in a fallen world, we acknowledge that even those most basic created good impulses have these terribly perverted shadow sides that exist in the world. And the distinction that you're making, I think, is between those basic impulses which will emerge in this crisis and the ways, the various directions that those basic impulses can be channeled and can go. And our job as thinkers, if we have one, I think, and as people planning routes toward the future out of this crisis, our job is to help channel those impulses in a positive direction.
And I think I know James wanted to raise this, and we talked offline about this, so it's probably a good note to end on. You know, amidst all this reevaluation of the value of owned space, to borrow a term from somebody, and the value of having your homestead, etc., you know, we should talk about a new Homestead Act. The original Homestead Act, which if none of you have read it, I encourage you to do so. Look it up. It's a beautifully succinct piece of legislation that issued from our Congress many, many decades and even a century and a half or over ago that sought to populate the American West with people who were self-reliant and tied to their property and their ability to sustain it. And so in a way, their ability to govern themselves and to contribute to a self-governing regime. But I wonder, you know, I mean, a lot of the American West is still owned by the feds. And it might be time for a new Homestead Act, you know, when we're all worried about our ability to retreat to a place that's safe and full of self-government in a way, if you'll forgive me for that oversimplifying phrase. You know, why not implore the federal government to sell off most of Nevada and other states in the West in which they own tons of property and allow people to live the American dream? Especially, you know, we've all noticed in the last 3 weeks and especially the last 2 weeks, you know, a lot of business in a certain part of the economy, I don't want to downplay the very real sense in which we still make things in this country, and you can't do that by Zoom conference. But there's a large part of the sort of knowledge economy, for lack of a better word, that can be conducted really from anywhere. So why not send us out to populate the wilds that still exist here in America, and thus to you know, offer us many safe havens from crowdedness, from, you know, virus spreading problems. But really, I mean, the spirit of it is not the sort of avoidance of plague, but rather the positive thing of getting back to the owning of property, the ruling of our own space, and the perpetuation of self-government. So
I just want to inject, so yes, to speak. We had a question earlier about the proper plural of the word virus and whether viri is acceptable. So I did just double check this using my digital lexicon, and virus, from which the word comes, originally meaning a potent juice.
That's not Church Latin.
So it is not
a potent juice,
an anathema to Church Latin, yeah. and
all ben, and long live Weenie Weedy Weechy. I agree with Churchill. Come on,
Weenie Weedy Weeky. In fact, it turns out
that's right.
It's terribly disappointing that is the correct pronunciation, but nevertheless, there it is. And a virus or a potent juice is, in fact, a second declension noun, meaning that viri or viri is the proper plural. Unlike, for example, octopus, which is based on a Greek noun, and therefore the proper plural is octopuses.
Right. This is not octopi.
This has been your etymology. Spencer,
see, this is why you're invaluable to these discussions.
It's because I
can't. Oh, I knew all about octopuses years ago, Matt.
Did you learn that from James Bond?
Yeah,
I don't even want to go there.
No.
I just want to say, and maybe this will be cut, but I just want to say this idea of the Homestead Act. I mean, imagine how freeing it would be for places like California to take federal land and get rid of all these regulations. And throughout the West, there is still so much land owned by the government. Imagine if it was opened up to development, to people, you know, of all persuasions, who want to build new communities, who want what the American dream has always really been about before World War II. They want to go out and reestablish a sense of community, a sense of belonging, and a kind of family life where they can provide for themselves and their children. And that's not impossible. I think we really sell ourselves short when, you know, so many people are so pessimistic, like, we can't do this. No, we can. We have the land. We could bring in people to attempt this sort of thing. And we could do that even in blue states, by the way, because you could, you know, this is my pitch for being governor of California. If you elect me governor, I mean, we're going to open up all that land between LA and San Diego. The Marines don't need all of it. I love them, but they don't need all of it. We're going to open up a lot of it, and it's going to be a zone in which we can build without this BS coming from the state and the counties. And I think that could apply, like you said, Nevada and a number of other places, and open up a new frontier in the interior of the U.S., which is what James was talking about in that Green Zone article. And I think that's powerful, and I don't think a lot of people have really caught on to it yet.
Yeah, it's too bad the elites, instead, what they do is just buy bunkers in obscure countries on the other side of the world.
Yeah.
A lot of the people that could be driving this, really pushing hard for this, their mentality, I think, is, well, it's, for whatever reason, they think it's an impossibility and better to decamp to, say, New Zealand.
Yeah.
Well, it's understandable, right? Because of how powerful the establishment is, which hates all this stuff and thinks what we're talking about is crazy, when what we're talking about is very natural and would make a lot of people happy. But you have an elite that just doesn't understand that at all.
Yeah, anyone who's driven from, you know, roughly speaking, San Clemente to Oceanside, to reference what Matt's talking about, across Camp Pendleton, if you have any sort of notion of real estate and real estate values, you wonder, I wonder what this is all worth. It's been a while since I looked it up, but it's I think it's 35 miles of coastline, and then it goes inland for probably 10. I forget, but it's an enormous, beautiful stretch of land. Matt, none of us could afford that portion of the new Homestead Act. We'd have to go into the interior, you know, Nevada or something like that. But
Well, I think after a lot of listeners hear this, they'll probably contribute to our small nonprofit, and you know, who knows?
Yeah, that's right.
We drove out. My boyfriend and I drove out to Joshua Tree last weekend, which just closed as we arrived, and it took us about 2.5 hours, which can hardly recommend. You can walk in, even though the park is closed, and spent a blissful day hiking 16 miles. We didn't even break the...
You could still walk in even though it's closed?
Yeah. You park on the outside of the border of the park, and they just sort of leave it to you. It was just empty.
Yeah.
You know, and it is this virus. I mean, in a more sort of squishy way, this virus is causing people, I think, to cling to the land all of a sudden, to cling to natural beauty and to be desperate for fresh air. And you see that people are going on walks when they could have gone on walks any day of the week. But it's suddenly this sort of precious last gasp of freedom, and people do it all the time. There's something definitely to be harnessed there.
Yeah, we should just end on this, but the revival of the neighborhood walk has been one of the things that I've noticed most conspicuously in this lockdown. My wife and I had our childcare options evaporate a couple of weeks ago, so we're sort of trading off and working in shifts, you know, throughout from 6 a.m. when the baby wakes up, he's about 14 months old, until you know, 10 p.m. when we both just sort of go to bed. So I've got morning shift often, and we'll walk around the neighborhood with the baby. And, you know, everyone keeps their respectful distance, but everyone's very friendly. I've got a couple of, you know, sort of more shelter-in-place, homestead-looking, to pull back a little bit about what we were talking about. Neighbors who refuse to engage or even talk to you, they're sort of hunkered down and, they're determined not to catch any viruses, so they keep... 10 to 12 feet away, not just 6. But otherwise, other than that, I mean, everyone's very friendly. You know, they want the baby to say hi to the dog. And, you know, it's been sort of, it's nice. You know, everyone's very friendly and solicitous, even though we all have to keep our distance. So, you know, it's an interesting time to be thinking about politics, the regime, and our predicament. So, well, here's to hoping, as we conclude tonight, the sort of madness of this doesn't continue on too much longer, while at the same time hoping that, you know, we can get back to a bit of semblance of normality without endangering the lives of some of our fellow citizens. So with that, we'll wrap up. Thank you for listening to The Roundtable. If you want to learn more, consider visiting our websites at AmericanMind.org, Claremont.org, and ClaremontReviewBooks.com. Don't forget to rate, review, share, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks to our engineering crew, Jake Gannon and Annalisa Lee. Thanks, everyone. Talk to you next week. Your bandwidth's so bad.
It gave me a button.
It's Robot Matt. Oh, this is going in the outtakes.
Can you guys talk about that? The Atlantic ran an article that said, "Stay alive, Joe Biden."
Oh, right. Like, well, we should talk. We need most from him. Oh, yeah.
Senile Grandpa Joe.
Man. No, I think that
yesterday was rough.
An anima. You know, a soul discussion about like what differentiates living from non-living things.
And Biden does not meet the test.
Biden is a material object hurtling through space.
It's like a Turing test, but for Biden.
Untamable Native King asked elsewhere, how come my kids have 10 years of physical education, but they're still obese? Ha 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 ha!